All right, everybody, today I'm going to be showing you a video I shot. It's been at least a year or two ago, but it's on how to build a foundry pattern for a cast iron angle plate. All right, everybody, welcome back to the old iron shop.
Well, it wouldn't be a workbench if it didn't get cluttered up a little bit. Alright, so the parts here, and this piece needs to be, okay, the dado is 4 inches. I want it to come up past it, so we'll go with 4 1/4. That should be plenty good enough. That side out there already. So I want the long grain to end up being the part that sits, let's get this together here for you. I want the long grain to be running between here and there, because it'll be easier to. I need to plane a taper on here. So that's what I'm gonna do. We're all ready here, so because I want an accurate cut, I'm gonna give myself a nice chisel notch to get into. And my smaller saw won't saw deep enough. So I'm gonna have to use a full-size handsaw here. Pattern maker's vise made by the Veritas company in Canada. I think that they have discontinued making this vise now, though. It's a copy of an old, an antique one, and they're expensive. This one was expensive. Bouncy stuff. That waste. We're back out here at the table saw. So we're gonna knock that off. More or less we need about 1/4 inch. The board is right on at 3/4. So that one's doing right. Yep, 3/4. We need a 1/2 inch tenon left over when we're done. We're gonna go just a little bit low. And when we're done, once we got the height set, we won't change that. What about that? Too much by 1/16 of an inch. That means we need to come up about a 32nd. Alright, that's saying 1/2 inch. Fits in the groove pretty good. Now we need to come over where we're 1/4 inch deep. Make sure not to measure this step too. Okay, 1/4. That'll fit. We got at least 1/4 inch extra there. Let's see what I'll turn this. Let's see what happens over here on this other edge, huh? You know, I think instead of going with the rip blade, just because I got the height just right and everything, this is going to be a joint buried inside of it anyway. Let's take a look here and see what we get, what kind of results we get cross-cutting with a rip blade. Just touch the edge with it there and see what we get. Actually, it was not very bad results. get this offset a quarter inch. Just making some relief. Give myself a good line. A little starting nick here with the chisel. Takes a little time, it's really easy. Okay, cross cut. Far enough back, move up a little bit. That should be enough. Yet I'm still fussing with it. Reason one side's a little tighter than the other. Alright, well, we'll go ahead and leave this one here. Cutting into the end grain here, so this is actually a rip cut. So I have a little dovetail saw here matched to my cross cut saw. Can't just pop that waste out. Get a saw on it. Use the cross cut here. Set up. One spot. Okay. That'll come together. Just need to fit the joints a little bit. Tough start here because we're starting right on a point. We're back at the bench hook here. So I don't need my safety glasses for this operation. Alright, I'm going to take this tool here, it's called a striking knife. Nice little line started there. Deepen it a little bit. And we're gonna score that with a chisel. Slapped a little notch in there real quick to try to help me. I don't know how well it's gonna work, but let's see what we get. Yeah, let's start from this side. Riding that groove a little bit. You guys are interested in woodworking and all, there's a guy, he used to be the editor for a popular woodworking magazine, but he's really into hand tool work. He has a whole system of, wow, that's really splitting out bad. It's a good thing we got a taper on there already, huh? Alright. That's a plenty good enough groove to follow with the saw. Carcass saw. It's not really a carcass saw. This is a saw that came out of an old miter box probably at some point. Remove the drain. Knock it over the end of the saw. Wanted to use this because this makes a much nicer, nice smooth cut. See, but that's a pretty good quality cut right there. It's not bad at all. All right, before I put this thing in the vise, I'm going to lay it flat in between these jaws, but that's awfully pointy, so I don't really want to tear up my leather, so I'm going to kind of just chamfer this off a little bit. Kinder to the leather in there. Won't really be losing any strength. That's right in the corner anyway, so. It's in there good and solid. Now, remember that this is the side that needs to be the thinnest, so let's put some lines on here so you can kind of see what's happening. So what I'm going to do, I think, I've got this thing here, and I'll just start planing on this edge a little bit. Well, you know what, that's going to be a cross grain, or actually, the grain is running this way. A lot better if I flip it around. I'll be playing in the wrong direction, and that's probably gonna tear out some grain. That's in there good. Kind of see bevel I'm putting on here. This is not exactly the best setup we could ever have. If you wanted to get real fancy, you could. We're going to make a whole bunch of these, maybe. Set up a block of wood and cut a shape into it, wedge it into it, kind of the way I held these pieces together. And then you could clamp it down to your bench top. Work on it like that. Taper on that. I think that's good on that side. Alright. Put in there like that. Good. Whoop. Other way. That. Now what we want to do, square corners are bad for pattern making. We got to round that up. So we'll just put that back in the vise here. Right here. Use a block plane. That's awfully light cut. Now, broke out some of the grain. That's all right. Again, there's going to be some filler going to have to go into those places anyway. All right, so that piece is pretty much done. Yeah, I just got a little bit of sanding on here, but I won't bore you with that. I hate to have to even bore myself with it, but somebody's got to do it, I guess. Well, I'm bound and determined to put that thing in there the wrong way. Okay, so that's going to fit like that. This piece right here. I'm gonna have to take a little bit off of those grooves. Let's see. Well, you know, probably the easiest way is to take a little touch off of this, maybe. That's a good fit. Oh, yeah, that one there is actually a pretty decent fit too. So we're gonna leave it just like that. Alright, so I'm gonna put a witness mark on here. That one goes there. And there. That's two marks. It goes there. Alright. Because now we can glue her up. Alright. Got it all sanded down. Guess we're ready to glue it back together. Or, well, glue it together. And put myself a little... what do they call that? A witness mark. Right here on this. And as long as this piece goes back where that witness mark is, and you know, everything will be in the same orientation. Probably don't really matter, but just a good practice, I guess. And I made sure to sand everything really nice and smooth. I had a couple of dents. Where was it at? Oh, they're right here. They're right there. And I just put a couple of drops of water on there and let it soak in for a minute. And then I just kind of heated it up with this torch. And the water soaks into the wood fibers and boils, and that forces the fibers back up. It was actually a pretty good dent, and hey, I got them out. Good enough for this. Once we're done, we're gonna put some sandable primer on there, and that'll fill in any really little fine defects, but we're doing pretty good. All right, so first thing, let out of there. And I want this miter to lay together really nice, right? Who doesn't want their miters to fit nice? So, trick for doing that, actually I probably should stick this thing in here so that it registers it good. So I'm gonna make this part a little bit harder, but so the trick. Anyway, trick is use some tape. This is just painter's tape. It's got a soft glue. So it won't get stuck on there forever. I put it on here. And close. Tape on it. This side. And then that'll make a hinge. We put some glue on there and then we hinge it shut and it'll actually make the tape tighten up just a little bit too once you fold it. And I was trying to stretch this tape. So it'll put together real nice and tight. There we go. Alright. Let's see how that goes. Oh yeah, see it? It doesn't even want to shut. Maybe it's too tight. There we go. Oh yeah, see it? It wants to spring open. But now we can just glue it like that. Set this guy in there. Okay, make sure we got all our stuff. Got some Tibon glue here, number 3. It's a waterproof one. Probably don't really need waterproof here, but it's just what I have on hand. Buying these popsicle sticks at the craft store for doing stuff like this. They're, I don't know, $1 for 100 of them or something. And then when it's done, you just throw it away. I've even used these little popsicle sticks as places to make a boss on patterns, you know, if you need a little, just a little very thin raised up section. Works really good for that. Okay. So it's good to make sure sometimes you get like a little pocket of air kind of under the glue, like right there. You can actually have problems with your joint because of that. When it starts to soak into the wood, it'll, you know, not be bound there. You know, you want it to all be connected real good. We don't want to put a ridiculous amount of glue on here, but we want enough. So we can get a little bit on there too, I guess. Building a piece of furniture here. This really is not critical for high strength. Get some glue down here. working window on this particular glue where it starts to bind or seize. So we should be fine here. That's one of the advantages of this over the original Tibon. It sets fast, which is good if you just need to fit something up quickly. You can even do what's called a rub joint. Take the two parts, fit them together, and joint taken. Now, for lack of a better clamp at hand, we're just going to use some tape, hold it in place. You see that thing needs to spring open still. Glue off of here. Wipe it off now, I won't have to deal with it later. Alright. Check her with the square. Almost perfect. All right. Well, that's it for this here for now. Let that set up, and then we'll see how to put fillets in here. Because that corner right there, it's going to be really sharp. When you go to take it out of the sand, it's going to be very delicate. A really tight 90 degree corner made out of sand is not very durable. So we'll fix that up.
All right, guys, I hope you enjoyed that little episode of Building Foundry Patterns. There's more of them. They'll definitely be linked in the video. If you enjoy this kind of stuff, please click on the horizontal mill icon to subscribe. And I'll have plenty more coming. I've got just about 100 videos as of right now. So there's plenty to keep yourself entertained. All right, see you around.